Hello together. And first of all, David sends his greetings, and he is very sorry that he cannot attend and that we had to make this last-minute change. But I hope, I'm not David, and I will not replace him, but I will try to give you some insights in our program, what we are working on in Novartis in the muscle field. So first of all, I learned about that only last Friday, and I found it very interesting about the meeting to learn that you are looking into the connection between muscle and bone, and then it came into my mind. And then it came into my mind that actually we are working in the so-called musculoskeletal disease area in Novartis. This is a combination of looking into muscle wasting. This is the part we are working on, but also on bone mineralization disorders. And so we have already established a few years ago this link between bone and muscle in our company. And the other thing, many characteristics like the repair, the pathways, TGF-beta, superfamily proteins, pro-inflammatory cytokines, AKT, and so on, and also mechanisms like aging or chronic diseases, we have heard about that today, which are in common. And so I think it's a very good idea to bring that together. Okay, you have heard already, what I wanted to do, I wanted to show you a few of our pathway work we have done in the last few years. So we actually started 7 years ago in Novartis with setting up a new muscle project or new muscle program. And we have in the meantime quite bright broad portfolio. And we are looking into atrophies, which is more what David is usually talking about, IGF. And I saw that there is a talk later on. And I will introduce you a little bit into muscle regeneration, aging, and senescence. So you have heard about this myostatin from the previous speaker, and just to make it clear, show you again, these are animals, and the only difference between this and this animal is that there is a deletion or a mutation in the myostatin. So you have that in all different species. This is a genetic model, but you have also natural occurring mutations. And here he has also showed you this boy who was born with this muscle phenotype. And a long time it was not clear, does myostatin loss in myostatin only gives you more muscle, or do you also have more function? And actually these whippets helped us to understand that there's really an improvement in muscle function. There was a study about 5 years ago, and they looked into these whippets, and they looked into homozygous and heterozygous mutations, and you can nicely see there was a two base pair deletion in the myostatin gene, which yielded in a premature stop codon and a reduced activity of myostatin. And what you can nicely see here, we have the three different genotypes. And A means these are the best racers. And you can nicely see that the heterozygous, most of them are really in this high race racing group. So this was the first time that it was really shown that these mutations also translate into a better muscle function. I think this is a very important point. It was raised a few times today, that it doesn't help us to have more muscle. We really have to have more functional muscle. And actually these, with this very high muscle mass, they are definitely not that good performers. So you have to find a balance to increase muscle and not to a big extent. So what we have done, when we started, of course, if you wanted to go into drug discovery, we knew it at first some in vitro systems where we can test our mechanisms and also test a lot of compounds and other things. And so at the time when we started, there was mainly used the C2C12 cells. And when we were in the myostatin field, we found out that this is not a very good system. And so we introduced we developed a new system for us, which using human skeletal muscle cells differentiation. And you can nicely see here that if you seed the cells at day zero, we grow them for 1 day, you get an increase in cell number. And then if you switch to differentiation media, we get a nice differentiation into muscle fibers. And these are stained with myosin heavy chain, which is a marker for differentiated muscles. So this enabled us also to measure to study myostatin. And so far, as I said, it was studied in C2C12 cells and usually recombinant myostatin. To have effects in a cellular system, you needed micrograms. And you can nicely see in our system, this is again showing the differentiation. So we added the myostatin during differentiation. And if I increase a little bit the the zoom, you can nicely see that you have much less myotubes in the cells which were grown in the presence of myostatin. And this was at the physiological concentration of 10 nanogram per milliliter. So this means we had a very nice in vitro system set up where we could measure differentiation, which is a very important part in muscle regeneration in many diseases. And then we went on, we had this very nice phenotypical readout, and we also looked into other readouts. So the one thing we did is measuring the fusion index. This means this is the number of nuclei which are in the differentiated muscle cells, and you can nicely see that under controlled conditions, if you add myostatin, you get a nice reduction, a dose-dependent reduction of the fusion index, so you inhibit differentiation. The other thing we saw is that the diameters of our muscle fibers were also reduced significantly upon stimulation with myostatin. And then, this is all imaging and quite labor intensive, but we can also measure, and it's very well known, CK activity. And the CK activity gave us exactly the same picture. So we have a nice dose-dependent decrease in differentiation or in the CK activity. So we have proven that this system correlates with the known readouts. And then, of course, very important markers of differentiation. MyoD is decreased in the Western blot. You can see nicely here by myostatin addition, and also myogenin as a terminal differentiation marker. So we have set up a very nice system now to test different pathways in this human skeletal muscle cells. And the first thing we were interested in to see, do these cells also respond to other TGF-beta protein family members? And here we just used the CK assay, which gives us a bigger throughput. And you can nicely see that not only myostatin, which are the black circles here, but also other family members nicely inhibited differentiation. So they complement for myostatin's anti-differentiation activity with different IC50, but all of these IC50s are really in the physiological range of these factors. And this comes also as one of the links to bone. So I think TGF-beta family members also play a big role in bone morphogenicity. And I will show you later that this is a very good link or very good interaction between muscle and bone physiology. The next, so myostatin is also called GDF8, is working via the ActRIIB receptor. So it's activating the ActRIIB receptor, then phosphorylating this ALK, this is activin-like kinase, and then further on with phosphorylating SMAD2-3 signaling. So what we were looking into is if inhibition of this pathway in our cultures have any influence of the differentiation of our human skeletal muscle cells. And more or less to see if we can, under in vitro condition, release myostatin and its family members. Okay, other way around, sorry. Okay, what you can see here, so if we did exactly the same experiment, so we cultivated now the cells under control condition, or we added follistatin. Follistatin is a natural inhibitor of not only myostatin, but also of activins. Or we added the ALK inhibitor, the ALK receptor inhibitor of SB43, 1542, you can nicely see that we increased differentiation. This means these cells in an in vitro system release TGF-beta family members, which can be, and have an endocrine, autocrine function on the differentiation, which can be blocked by these pathway inhibitors. And you can also nicely see not only that we have higher fusion index, we also have much broader or much thicker myotubes under these conditions. Again, we did the analysis of the statistics, so we can nicely see here fusion index. Here for the control again, this is myostatin 10 and 100 nanogram, it's inhibiting fusion index. And the ALK inhibitor or the follistatin alone increased fusion index by up to 70%. And in the presence of these inhibitors, myostatin could not inhibit differentiation anymore. So it does not only prevent the autocrine negative feedback loop, it also prevents action of exogenously given myostatin. The same, you can see the same readout with the diameters. It's decreased. You have more bigger myotubes in the presence, and then you can prevent the myostatin inhibition. And exactly the same we can see in the CK activity. The next question we were asking is, we said that we have here the ActRIIB is a main receptor for myostatin, and then it's transphosphorylation via ALK4 SMAD2-3. So we were asking the question if this inhibition is dependent on SMAD2-3. And to do this, we have downregulated by SI experiments SMAD2 and 3, and we could clearly show that this inhibition is due to SMAD2 and 3 activation. Okay. Then, as I said before, there are a lot of hypertrophy pathways, and we were interested to see how do these inhibitory pathways, the TGF-beta pathways, interact with, for example, the IGF-AKT pathway. And a few years ago, David and his group has established this constitutive active AKT mouse, and you can nicely see that they have a lot of muscle and almost no fat left. And if you look into a myostatin knockout mouse, you have a very similar thing. So you have much more muscle, and it's not that nicely shown, but there's also very low fat. So the question was if there's any interaction between the myostatin and the AKT pathway. And for this, we... This is the right way, no. This way around, sorry. Okay, and so what we saw is that if you give myostatin to these cultures for 24 hours, you can nicely see that the phosphorylated AKT is going down. And if we block this MAT2-3 pathway, we don't see this decrease. So this shows the interaction that the TGF-beta or TGF-beta is doing exactly the same thing, so that the TGF-beta myostatin pathway via MAT2-3 inhibit AKT phosphorylation, and you can prevent that by blocking this MAT2-3 pathway. Okay. So then further downstream of AKT, you have this TORC pathway, for example, TORC1. And so we were interested to see how these pathways interact, how the inhibition goes further. And so what we did, we knocked down RUCTOR and RICTOR also in this skeletal muscle cells, and then to look what the influence of protein synthesis is. And if you look now into that, this was quite interesting, that if you have RUCTOR knockdown, you can facilitate the effect of myostatin. And you have also an inhibition by the treatment alone. And then we thought, how can this be? And then we measured the phosphorylation of SMART and FOXIO, and can nicely see that under control condition, you have phosphosmart. And if you knock down RUCTOR, this phosphosmart signaling is increased. This shows us that under normal condition, RUCTOR is inhibiting SMART signaling. And if you block that, you can further increase SMART signaling inhibition of differentiation, which is nicely shown here in this CK assay. Okay, this came then after all these studies, we came up with a pathway for myostatin, how it acts in muscle differentiation. So myostatin, also TGF-beta, I haven't shown you these data, which are very similar to myostatin, acting via the ActRIIB or the TGF-beta receptor, inhibiting SMART, then activating SMART, then inhibiting AKT, which then activates mTOR, and this gives a negative feedback to SMART2-3. So we have found a very nice interaction between IGF and myostatin. And interestingly, the IGF, if you activate IGF, there's no difference in the SMART signaling so ever. So this seems to be a unilateral interaction. Okay, then what I said is this is a very nice link between the muscle and bone thing. So as also Professor Kiel said, the myostatin has also been recently shown to be also a key a factor in muscle, in bone structure and bone disease. So what you can nicely see here, this is a very recent publication on the myostatin knockout mouse. You can nicely see that here the muscles have a bigger diameter, the bones have a thicker diameter, and also where the muscle is attached is much bigger, and the spinal cord is also much bigger here and here. So it's a very nice prove that there's actually common pathways in the myostatin and also other TGF-beta superfamily members within muscle and bone. And also, I've seen this publication, which was cited in the talk before, that there's a association between a myostatin gene polymorphism and the BMD variations in Chinese population. So it was a long time that people thought that myostatin is exclusively working on muscle, but there's more and more evidence now that it's also involved in bone remodeling and growth. And this was myostatin, and as I have shown you before, TGF-beta is a big family of proteins, and there are lots of mechanisms which are in common between muscle and bone, and there are, for example, TGF-beta plays a role in both muscle and bone differentiation, and there are plenty of opportunities to intervene with these pathways and to have a common therapeutic for both muscle and bone diseases at the same time. Okay, so the next thing what was also said a few times today is that chronic inflammation is one of the settings where we have very often bone loss and also muscle loss. And this is, for example, mediated by pro-inflammatory cytokines. And it has been known for a long time that TNF-alpha and IL-1 inhibits the differentiation of muscle cells, which you can see here. So this is a control, and you have much less myotubes if you incubate in the presence of IL-1 and TNF-alpha. And so we now used our muscle cell system to analyze how this inhibition is occurring, if this is a direct mechanism or maybe it involves other mechanisms. And so what we did here for the first time, we looked into interaction with the IGF and the TGF-beta pathway. And interestingly, IGF-1 and the ALK inhibitor both increased differentiation, but they also reduced the inhibitory effect of IL-1 and TNF-alpha in the system. So this was, if you look here, we have the fusion index measured, and you can nicely see that there is an increase by the compounds alone, and also the decrease by IL-1 and TNF-alpha is reduced by these two treatments. And so we were wondering, how is this interaction going on? And I've shown you before that if you give SB, there seemed to be a release of TGF-beta molecules. And our idea was maybe that this interaction may be due to the release of TGF-beta protein family members. And so what we did is that we actually analyzed, so have put you a scheme to it because it's quite complicated, this experimental setting. So we had the myoblasts, which we differentiated in the myotubes. And then we took this supernatants from the myotubes and put them in the Kagerluk reporter, which we used as a biosensor to measure TGF-beta activity, like in ELISA, but just as a biological activity. And then we looked here in this ELISA, in this reporter gene assay, what the different components of this response were by using pharmacological inhibitors. At the same time, we did later an activin A ELISA, and also we measured to show that there's really an influence on the differentiation mechanism. We measured CK activity. And as you can nicely see here, this is under control condition, and please look at the scale. We had got a nice response of the supernatants in this reporter gene assay showing that our muscle cells have released TGF-beta molecules. And when we used pharmacological inhibitors, we could show that most of this response is really TGF-beta 1, 2, 3 isoforms. We added the TGF-beta receptor, the soluble. If we then stimulated the cells with IL-1 and TNF-alpha, please look, this is a 10 times bigger scale. We got a huge increase in this TGF-beta activity. And now the TGF-beta receptor did not prevent this response, but the activin A antibody did. So this means this in AL1 and TNF-alpha induced response is due to activin A, which is released under the stimulation of IL-1 and TNF-alpha. The next thing, so we looked what happens if we give an anti-activin A antibody or an TAC inhibitor, a P38 inhibitor, or an NF-kappa B inhibitor. These are all pathways known, molecules known to be in the TNF-alpha and IL-1 pathway here. And you can nicely see if you give an anti-activin A antibody, you don't get any activin A in the supernatants, and you can also reduce the activin A response if you give a TAC1 inhibitor, the P38 inhibitor, and NF-kappa B inhibitor. This shows that TNF-alpha and IL-1 via TAC1 and the downstream targets induce activin A production in these cells. We later, as I said, also proved that, so we were interested to see if this activin A production is dependent on SMAD2-3. And it's very nice what you can see here. If you knock down the gene encoding for the activin A, you don't get any activin A activity in this after IL-1 and TNF-alpha induction. But if you knock down SMAD2 and 3, you still get the full activin A production. This means activin A itself is de novo synthesized, and it's independent of the SMAD2-3. So the inhibition of the effect of SMAD2-3 comes only after activin A is produced. To further validate that, so we have also measured the same in the activin A ELISA, just to make sure that our biosensor measures indeed activin A. You can nicely see that activin A is increased upon IL-1 and TNF-alpha stimulation, and you can again, with the same inhibitors, you can inhibit this response. So the next thing we were interested is if this changes in the supernatants also translate into a phenotypical change, and you can nicely see here that the TAC inhibitor and the activin A antibody both can counteract the IL-1 and TNF-alpha induced inhibition of differentiation. You can nicely see here the counteraction of these two components. The same I show you only the CK activity for the P38 and NF-kappa B inhibitor, and you can nicely see again the phenotypical change is also inhibited by P38 and NF-kappa B inhibition. And again, we did the knockdown of the activin A encoding gene and of SMAD2-3, and here you can nicely see both inhibin beta A gene suppression as well as SMAD2-3 increases the differentiation and counteracts the TNF-alpha and IL-1 responses, showing that this phenotypical change, of course, you can see if you knock down SMAD2-3 again, showing that this is due to the activin A which is released from the cells. The next step we did, we wanted to understand these two different signaling events. So we have this immediate signaling, which is what is shown on this part here. So TNF-alpha induces phospho-TAC, phospho-MKK4, phospho-P38, and jejun, and NF-kappa-B responses. You can nicely see here. And at this early time point of 10 minutes, you don't see any SMAD2 or SMAD3 phosphorylation. And all these immediate responses are counteracted by TAC inhibitors, meaning that this is really the entry point from the pathways we have looked into this pathway. And if you look into a delayed or 24-hour time point, you can nicely see that now phospho-SMAD comes up, and this is exactly the time point when we can also measure activin A in the supernatant. So you can see phospho-SMAD2 and phospho-SMAD3 goes up, and all the inhibitors prevent this this activation, showing that this is the early and this is the late event, and this activin A has to first be built before you can have a SMAD phosphorylation event. So this is a little bit bigger now, the pathway we have came up with. And again, this is a pathway very likely it could also be involved in bone loss, because as we said before, chronic inflammation is also involved in bone loss, and we have also a lot of these components in the bone cells, so one could easily try if this is a mechanism which links cytokines to TGF-beta signaling in bones as well. So the last part I wanted to talk about is, of course, we cannot do everything in vitro. We also have to go in vivo, and the ideal situation would be that we can test everything in humans, but this is not the case, so we have to have something in between. And we came up with a sarcopenia model where we just analyzed aged animals. And sarcopenia actually is a disease where you have a reduced muscle mass in elderly people. You have also more fat, what we heard before, more fat and more fibrosis tissue. And at the end of the day, the problem is that people get immobile and they cannot stand up anymore and do their daily activity. And we have used aged rats to look into these mechanisms. You can nicely see that these rats also age and a very similar phenotype at humans. And the interesting thing is, so the muscle weight is the first thing which decreases is a tetanic force before the weight changes. So the physiological changes come before the muscle mass changes. I think this is a very important part for us. And we have done extensive, so we have looked into this pathway I've just described to you with TNF-alpha, TAC1, and Activin A. And you can nicely see these are 6, 18, 21, and 24-month-old rats. And you can nicely see that phosphosmad is activated, phosphoTAC1 is activated, and also PSOP38. Here are the densitometric analysis of this pathway. This means the pathway I've just described is a chronic with a TNF-alpha pro-inflammatory cytokines is upregulated in aging, and we know also that in our animal model the TNF-alpha levels in the circulation are up, and the expression on the muscle field in the muscle area is also that Activin A is upregulated, and many other of these of genes involved in this pathway, which I didn't show you here. We did a full analysis of this model in an expression profiling, and we have got some very interesting patterns. For example, here's one where you can see a decrease in genes at the same time as you see a decrease in function, or here an increase in function. So we have a lot of different profiles, and I just want to show you a few of them. And for example, we have some aging markers which are upregulated, P16-INC4, for example. Then the MRF and MAFPOX here, these are the general atrophy markers, and here only MRF is a little bit upregulated, MAFPOX not. But what we found is that in general mitochondrial function is decreased in aging. And another finding, which is also in relation to previous talks today, the neuromuscular junction is definitely also impaired. So we found a lot of interesting starting points for further mechanisms analysis. And what we have recently set up is also an in vitro system to measure, to look into aging. And so we have muscle cells from different donor ages. And the interesting thing is, similar as in the animal models, we could observe this delayed differentiation phenotype. You can see here, after 48 hours, the cells from the 17-year-old donor are already starting to differentiate, whereas the 83-year-old donor, you have almost no differentiation. And if you can nicely see that here if you measure the fusion index. And so we have now also a system where we can test or we can simulate in vitro some of these aging events in muscle diseases. And here again, we have now expanded our panel to more donors, and you can nicely see how the myogenic expression in young it's going very nicely up, whereas in old it's not going up that much. So we can really reproduce the phenotype of an impaired delayed muscle differentiation in vitro. And I think another important part, and this is the last thing I will talk about, is this senescence. I think we have heard today about the environment of the cells, of aged cells, and there's a lot of this, that there's a senescence-associated secretory phenotype. And one of, and I think this is a very important thing, and we could mimic in our cellular system, if you passage the cells for several times, we get an increase in beta-galactosidase staining, and also the morphology changes totally. And so this gives us another possibility to look into senescence. And I think this is also a common pathway which could be involved also in bone diseases. And so I want to come to an end. So this is, I wanted to thank David Glass who set up this muscle group, and I think we have reached some interesting findings already. Here are the people who were directly involved in these studies I've shown today, and of course the entire muscle fib group in Basel and in Cambridge. Thank you very much for your attention.
I guess we can take a question or two, or just a little bit behind.
Mark Fabreo, Melbourne. When you inhibit activin, or you're driving, preventing atrophy or driving hypertrophy, do you ever look at the insulin sensitivity of your cells? Because mTOR can inhibit insulin signaling by serine phosphorylating IRS1. So one of the things about that is a bit of a conundrum with muscle growth versus muscle metabolism is that on one hand you can drive hypertrophy, but you run the risk of inducing insulin resistance. So do you ever look at the insulin, the effect of your models on metabolic processes?
We have looked into metabolic things, and let's say this way, these are all experimental drugs I've shown today, but in our clinical program we have looked into that, and most of the mechanisms are rather positive for metabolic diseases than negative. Because also in metabolic disease you have this increased TGF-beta signal, TGF-beta protein family signaling and other things. So we would rather think it's positive from the literature, but we have not used these compounds in vivo,
right,
which
thanks.
I've shown you today.
If I could follow up on that, I think that that conundrum is, at least from the muscle signaling field, is a very real question. So the idea is that the canonical or classical mTOR signaling pathway, if it's activated, should be inhibiting IRS1 or phosphorylating IRS1 and making the muscle insulin resistant. But yet in almost all models we know of muscle hypertrophy, mTOR activity is on for hours, if not days. And I think the little bit we've started to look at this a little bit more directly, and so there is in my mind there's a question as to whether that aspect of the pathway is actually active in skeletal muscle, because we don't see that kind of insulin resistance during hypertrophy.
Yeah, the only thing that sort of throws a spanner in the works there is there are data that rapamycin inhibition of mTOR actually improves obesity-induced insulin resistance. So,
sure. I'm just talking about muscle-specific. Just looking specifically at muscle hypertrophy models, under conditions in which mTOR activity is elevated for 36 hours at least, and we're still seeing insulin responsiveness because AKT's already come down. But if we hit them with insulin, we still get them.
And we should not forget that we have always an endogenous tone in our systems. So we have a kind of an atrophy system and not a normal wild-type system. And whenever we test something in a mouse, it's usually also a very high tone of myostatin. So we have to see what happens if you go in a human being. Yeah, this tone is much lower, definitely. Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much.